Good morning. It's 1:30 in South Africa, and what a match we just saw. Well played, Argentina, by beating the Springboks today in Santiago. You played brilliantly. The Springboks didn't take all their chances, but you deserved the win. It all sets up the Rugby Championship nicely for a final next week when the two teams will again meet in Mbombela, South Africa this time. And with the Springboks having 19 points on the locks and the Pumas 14, there's all still to play for. In this video, I will go through the key moments in the match. I'll give you my halftime thoughts and then the full-time match thoughts. I will also look at some key takeaways from the match as well as statistics. If you like this video, please hit that like button and please, please subscribe to my channel. It will be much, much appreciated. Thank you. It is Argentina that kicks off to start the match. And in the second minute already, there's a very strong scrum by South Africa. They push the Argentina scrum backwards and it's a penalty to South Africa and they go for the sidelines. From the resulting lineout, the Springboks scores a brilliant try. They go for a maul from the lineout. It doesn't go for the far, the ball comes out. It goes from Lukanya to Pollard, who passes to Fassi, who slices clean through and scores. And Pollard converts the try, and the score within the third minute of the match is 7 points to the Springboks, 0 points to Argentina. In the eighth minute, the Springboks takes the ball through various phases. A flanker, Ben Jason Dixon, offloads to Jesse Creel. He's clean through and he scores next to the post. And Pollard converts, and the Springboks are ahead within 8 minutes of the match by 14 points to nothing. In the ninth minute, there's another penalty to South Africa. The Argentina team are making far too many mistakes at this time, and Pollard again goes for the sideline. In the 11th minute, there's another penalty to South Africa when Los Pumas illegally try and rip the ball. Pollard goes for the poles, he kicks it over, and the Springbok leads by 17 points to nothing, and the Argentinian team at this stage are all over the place. In the 15th minute, Argentina however starts their fight back. There's a move down the blind side, the switch play. Carreras goes through, I think it's Marco van Staden that misses the tackle. He goes over and he scores, and Albanos converts the try, and the score is 17 points to South Africa and 7 points to Argentina. In the 18th minute, there are a key moment in the match that will change the flow of the match in the favour of Argentina. Kurtley Andrensa goes for a tackle. He dips slow to take the tackle. The Argentina player also, however, dips. To my mind, it looks like Kurtley Andrensa hits him on the chest. And yes, then his shoulder then moves up from the chest for head contact on the chin, but it's very slight and very marginal. However, the referee has nothing of it, and Kurtley Andrensa is sent off the field, and the Springbok will have to play for 10 minutes with 14 men. Albanos goes for the poles, he however misses from the resulting penalty, and the score stays 17 to South Africa and 7 to Argentina. In the 19th minute, Argentina steals a Springbok lineout, and the referee announces that the yellow card won't be upgraded to a red card. I think that's quite a relief for the Springboks. In the 21st minute, there's a well-taken try by Matera. The maul is moved by the Argentina backline behind the wall of players in front of them. It disrupts the Springboks' rush defense, and Matera is able to go through and score, and the conversion is over, and the score all of a sudden is 17 points to South Africa and 14 to Argentina. It's obvious at this stage that the momentum has swung totally to Argentina. They're controlling the ball, they're moving it very well, they do a lot of switch move. Albanon at the fly-off dictates the game, and the Springboks are battling to contain the Argentina players with only 14 men on the field. There's a lot of space on the field in the back line and the back division that Argentina are exploiting very well at this stage. In the 25th minute, there's a penalty to Argentina. They kick the ball forward and the Argentina player tries to regather. To my mind, he loses it forward, and then the Springbok player dives on the ball, doesn't release it, and it's a penalty to Argentina, but to my mind it should have first been a scrum to South Africa. However, the penalty stands. A minute later, in the 26th minute, there's a try to Scavia from a line out. The Argentina take the line-out ball in the middle of the line-out. They however do a clever move to peel around the front. The Springbok pack firstly defends very well. They pushes Argentina to the sidelines. And just as the ball is about to go over the sidelines, it's passed inward. Scavia catches the ball and he forces himself over for Argentina's try, a very well taken try. The officiating team take a quite careful look at this try. They want to see if the ball is out before it's passed inward. They look at it from various angles, and quite correctly it's decided that the ball was passed into the field before the Argentinian players was pushed over the line by the Springboks. It's caught by Scavia, he pushes over for a try in the corner. However, unfortunately, the conversion is missed, but Argentina takes the lead for the first time in the match, and they lead by 19 points to 17. In the 28th minute, Kurtley Arons is back onto the field, and I made a note at this stage that the Springboks were kicking too much aimlessly. There's one particular kick where Reinach got the ball, I don't know, I think it was from a ruck or a line-out, I'm not sure. He then kicked the ball over his head and gave position immediately back to Argentina, to the dangerous back line to attack. And I made a note what a senseless kick that was by Reinach. In the 33rd minute, there is the second penalty in a row for Argentina. They decide to do a move close to the Springbok try line. There's a dummy, and Albano goes over and scores. Very well played by Argentina. They've scored at this stage 4 tries in the first half to only 2 by the Springboks, and they are well deservedly in the lead by 26 points to 17. The 37th minute, there's another bad kick by Reinach, and I make a note here in my note saying, what is he doing? However, it's also a penalty to the Springboks, and let's see if they can take advantage of this penalty. From the resulting line-out, the Springboks get another penalty, and Reinach redeems himself to an extent when he takes a quick tap, he evades a number of Argentina players, and goes over and score in the corner. The conversion is however missed, and it's halftime with Argentina being in the lead 26 points to 22 by South Africa. The players go into the shed, and I think the Argentinian team will be the most happy with their first half performance. It's a testing test in Santiago. In that first half, it was very hot and humid, 36 degrees. You can clearly see that some of the players were struggling in the heat. What was telling in the moment, I think, was the yellow card of Kurtley Arons. It robbed the Springboks from their momentum, but Argentina must also be given a lot of credit for the way they exploited space with him being off the field, for their clever moves in the back line by their switch play. They caught the Springboks quite unaware a number of times, and the Springboks uncharacteristically missed quite a number of tackles, and I'm sure Rassi will have a talk to them about that in the shed, that they need to up their tackle tempo. They need to match the Argentinians. Perhaps they also need to slow down the ball a bit. If they make it too quick and they make mistakes, then the Argentinians can feed off those mistakes and they can exploit it, as was shown in the first half. Argentina scoring 4 tries in the first half against the Springboks, 3 tries. In my notes on the first half, I indicated that I think the Springboks or Rassie needs to bring on the bomb squad earlier. I think they need the firepower of Etzebeth and Quagga up front to stabilize the game for themselves and to take them over the line. And it's therefore all still to play as the second half is about to start. Springboks kick off to start the second half. They immediately go on to attack. They take the ball through a number of phases around the ruck with their forwards. The Argentinians concede a penalty. Pollard goes for the poles. It's over. And there's a 1-point difference between the teams in the 43rd minute, with Argentina leading 26 points to South Africa's 25. In the 47th minute, the Springboks bomb squad comes on. Eben Etzebeth replaces Salman Murat, and by doing so, he equals Victor Matfield's record of 127 test matches for the Springboks as lock. Also on for the Springboks are Quagga Smit, Elrich Lowe and Manny Lebok. In the 49th minute, there's another penalty to the Springboks. They go for the poles, Manny Lebok kicks it over, and the Springboks go into the lead again for the first time since they've been up 17 to nothing in the first half. They lead by 28 points to 26. And I also noted that Kulisi was out of the coaching box at this stage. He was on the sideline edging his team on for the rest of that tight second half. In the 51st minute, there's a penalty to Argentina. Albanos goes for the poles, he misses it, and the score remains South Africa 28 and Argentina 26. Quite a crucial miss by Albanos at this stage. In the 54th minute, there's a penalty to Argentina when one of the Springbok players from a high kick pushes one of the Argentina players in the back. They are penalized. To my mind, it could also have been Argentina player that crossed, and the push from the back was ever so slightly perhaps a bit of a harsh call, but still a penalty to Argentina. Both teams at this stage look off their field in the heat and the humidity, and Hendricks also comes on for the Springboks to replace. In the 59th minute, there's a scrum penalty to South Africa. They are by now totally dominant at the scrum times, and they go for the sidelines. In the 62nd minute, I made a note that the match has become very stop-start. It moves from one set piece to another. There's not the fluency they were in the first half and the first part of the second half. And it's clear that both teams are taking strain in the heat and humidity. Rugby is not as free-flowing as it used to be before in the match. At the same time, Kramer is injured for Argentina. He's out on the field for quite a long time where he's being tended to. The referee stopped the play. I thought it was a bit unfortunate because although he was lying injured and the back line of the Springboks were moving to his side, they were clearly already running past where he was laying. And it was, they had an overlap, and if the referee let the ball go there, the Springboks might have scored. However, he stopped the game for the medics to come on and attend to Kramer, and Kramer then goes off the field. As I said, I think it was a bit of a unfortunate, firstly that Kramer got injured, that he had to go off. He was a real grafter and grifter for Argentina, and what a player he is. But also, unfortunately for the Springboks, that a flowing move was stopped where they had an overlap that could perhaps have led to a score. In the 64th minute, another key moment in the match, it's a penalty for South Africa. Manny Lebok is going for the sideline. He tries to kick it as close as possible to the Argentinian goal line. He overcooks it, and the ball goes out behind the corner post, and it's a scrum midway for Argentina. If he was a bit more conservative, the Springboks would have had a very good line-out on the Argentinian trine line, and they would have definitely attacked the line. And to my mind, that was after Kurtley Arends' yellow card, the second key moment in this match. 66th minute, there is loose play. The ball is bobbing around. Hendricks takes the ball, and he tries and flips an underhand pass to a non-existent Springbok. He places his team under a lot of pressure, and I'm making a note on what the hell is he doing. And I think both him and Reinach didn't have the best of days in this match and put their team under unnecessary pressure. Reinach with some senseless kicking, and Hendricks with just throwing a loose pass that nearly caused his team some problems. In the 67th minute, there's a penalty to Argentina as Steenkamp doesn't roll away quickly enough at the ruck. Albanos goes for the poles, he kicks it over, and Argentina regains the lead, and the score is now 29 points to Argentina and 28 points to South Africa. 71st minute, Rian Ortiz is down cramping. He had a very good match. He was all over the park, defending, taking the ball on into the Argentinas. He was rocking well, and he's got a real engine. He reminds me very much of Mostert, and I think he's a future prospect for the Springboks. However, he needs to leave the field injured. And by this stage, Jan-Hendrik Wessels is also the field, playing at hooker as Malcolm Max has gone off. In the 72nd minute, there's a bit of a buzzing call by the referee. Fassi is taking out after he kicks the ball. He goes to the ground. Because of that, he can't run and put his players onside. And the referee gives a penalty to Argentina, as he indicated that the Springbok players did not retreat. But my question is, how could Fassi put them online if he was taken out late? The referee doesn't review the matter, however, and it stays a penalty for Argentina. In the 74th minute, Argentina are on attack. However, the Springbok gets the ball, but it's a very bad clearing kick by Hendrik. So the ball doesn't go out far, and the Argentinians are keeping putting pressure on the Springboks while they hit also on the scoreboard. So both scoreboard pressure and player pressure from the Argentinian side, and the box really need to scramble to try and rescue this match and take the rugby champions outright already in Argentina. In the 77th minute, I make a note of something that I picked up happening quite a number of times in the match. The referee Ridley calls time off. He wants to talk to both set of front rowers. He stops the clock at, as my note says, 77 minutes and 52 seconds. Although he calls stop the clock, it's not stopped until about 10-15 seconds later. This happened quite a few times throughout the match that I could observe. In the 78th minute, the Springboks are on attack. They get a penalty for an Argentina player not rolling away. It's not too difficult to kick. Mani Lebok steps up and one would expect him to kick it over. However, he misses it and Argentina stays ahead 29 points to 28. Quite an inexcusable miss of an easy penalty by Mani Lebok. From the resulting kickoff, the Springboks desperately try and attack. They go through a number of phases, but quite from deep in their own half, they don't go very far. The forwards try and take the ball up, and they try their utmost. However, they concede a penalty in the 81st minute. Argentina can just tap the ball and kick it out, and they win deservedly so by 29 points to 28 in a hard-fought match. Well done, Argentina, and I will come back with my full-time reflections. In terms of my full-time notes, I've indicated that I thought Argentina played very well. The backline had some slick move. Albano, the fly-off, is a real find. He often switches quickly around from the one side of the field to the others. He caught the Springbok defense napping. They sometimes move the ball behind a set of forwards. That negated the Springboks' rush defense. The Springboks also uncharacteristically tonight missed quite a number of tackles that let Argentina score at least two of their four tries, where normally they would have made good tackles. So Argentina played very well. They were under pressure up front, though, especially at scrum half time. The Springboks were demolishing them in the scrums and won quite a number of scrum penalties. In the lineouts, matters were far more even. There were a few overthrows by South Africa, a few lost lineouts by South Africa, but also by Argentina. And the loose ball, I will look at the statistics later. But to my mind, in terms of the rucks and the mauls, the game was also very much even. I think tonight's match turned on three key points that I noted down. I've already spoken about it. In the first half, Kirtley and Arendse were yellow carded. Up to that stage, the Springboks were in absolute control of the match. However, them having only 14 men with the Argentinian dangerous backline spelled trouble. The Argentinians moved the ball quite well around. They exploited the space and they scored a number of tries during the period that Kirtley Arendse was off the field. I think it just indicates again how important discipline is in modern rugby. And although it was a marginal call, I think it would have given nine times out of ten, it would have been given a yellow card the way the contact situation is refereed these days. I don't necessarily personally agree with it, I think it's sometimes done a bit overzealously so. However, in most matches that would have been a yellow card, and the total momentum swung and Argentina took their chances, which was very well done. The second turning point for me in the match was when the Springboks in the second half started to gain the ascendancy again. They went into the lead. There was a penalty awarded to the Springboks, and Mani de Lebok decided to, and the Springboks decided to go for the sideline, and Mani de Lebok, rather than kicking conservatively, tried to get it as close as possible to the Argentinian line. He overcooked it. It went behind the corner post, and it was a scrum at halfway for Argentina. And I think that was really halted the Springboks momentum, because in my mind, up to that stage, they were slowly but surely getting the upper hand, although in a very grinding fashion. It wasn't very pretty rugby, but the Argentinian players started to look very tired. The Springboks also, but at least they had the majority of the possession and territory at that stage. Of course, the third turning point was Mani Lebok's missed kick. It was not a difficult kick. He's got a tendency to kick over the very difficult kicks, and then sometimes the easier ones like this one he misses. I think that was another key moment. If it went over, I think the Springboks would have won the match. However, there's no grudges. I think Argentina played very well. I think on the balance of probabilities, they deserved to win. The crowd was very passionate. It supported them greatly. They at times played out of their skins, especially in the back line. Really took it to the Springboks, tested the Springboks defense like it wasn't tested by the likes of New Zealand or the Wallabies. And I think they fully in the end deserved to win. It sets up the championship very nicely. And we'll see next week in Mbombela who will come out on tops, and which of these two teams will walk away with the rugby championship. In terms of match statistics, unfortunately I couldn't find any online after the match. Normally they are available on ESPN quite quickly, but for some reason it wasn't provided in time, so sorry for that. But however, let's look at some of the key takeaways from the match, and for that I'm going to rely on the Planet Rugby article. The five takeaways are the following, and I'm just going to read through it in terms of the top line. It was an historic win by Los Pumas in Santiago against the world champions that set their fans into raptures as the magnificent new stadium hosted the 10th test. It was a war of attrition, a day of spiral bombs, scrums and errors, as four brilliant tries by Los Pumas from Pablo Matera, Matteo Carreras, Thomas Albanos and Joe Sclavi played three from the Springboks courtesy of Jesse Creel, Kobus Reinig and Apolela Fassi. The match was played in absolute insane conditions, starting off at 30 degrees, giving the players a torrid time on the field, resulting in a match of many handling errors and no real shape. But Los Pumas under the pump at the scrum time picked apart in the first 5 minutes and hammered in the aerial contest, held on through desires, superior creativity with the ball in hand, and another massive display from the back five in their pack. Argentina have had some incredible rugby moments in recent time, and in this year's rugby championship, they've now beaten all three teams of the opposition, South Africa, New Zealand, as well as Australia. In terms of the second team takeaway from Planet Rugby, they indicated what could go wrong will go wrong, but it could have also been so different. David Campisian said in his preview that he wasn't always sure which version of the Los Pumas will actually turn up at all. And with South Africa attacking in their 22nd from only the second phase, the offense of the Argentina simply failed to relate and make any form of line, and holes appeared at midfield the size of the Cape Plains, and Fassi needed no second invitation to take advantage of a defensive lull and open the scoring. Not content with giving one try, Los Pumas' focus remained in the dressing room as Jesse Creel went through and sliced through for another try. And they were busy complaining about Ben Jason Dixon going miles past the ruck to ruin the defense, and they paid the price. It was a horrendous start to the game from Argentina. However, they managed to pull it back quite nicely. The third takeaway from Planet Rugby is a 19-point yellow, and when Kurt Lee Arensley saw a yellow card for a shoulder to the head of Mateo Carreras, nobody could have foreseen what would have happened in the next 10 minutes. 6 points is the average contested in Test Rugby in terms of the yellow card sin bin period. However, in this instance, Argentina scored 19 points when Kurt Lee-Arensley was off the field, and that was quite a critical and turning point in the match. In terms of the another takeaway from Planet Rugby, they say the heroes all for Argentina, heroes abound from 1 to 15, but for a side that was seen used to be bashing their way to win, it was their back division which must take the plaudits in this match. In the centre, Koba Harris, a player who had a wonderful season in Europe, shone like a beacon. He tore the Springboks defence apart time and time again, getting outside of Lucania M for the first Las Pumas try and holding the Bok defence and passing around and behind it for another. At 10, whilst he had lots of issues with extra stats and restarts, Albemos' ability to break on the outside shoulder and step back against the grain caused South Africa no end of issues, and it was fitting that there was another batting run from the fly-off that saw Argentina score their fourth try. For the Springboks, the takeaway is there's some Bok problems. This is the first time the Springboks have wobbled in this campaign, and bearing in mind that it was largely an experimental side, so there is some benefit of the doubt that must go their way. However, putting it bluntly, the midfield defence of the Springboks simply didn't work. They rushed too quickly at times when blitzing, and it failed to maintain essential alignment. When players rush out at that speed, if the structure is not pinpointed, then holes appear, and that's exactly what allowed Gobaris and Albornoz to break through and scramble or offload on far too many occasions. In the back row, there was a lack of intellect and balance, other than an outstanding shift from Marco van Staden over the ball. When faced with players the size of Matera and Marcos Kramer, route one isn't the best route to the success, and time and again, Jasper Wiese and the big Bok carriers were smashed as they went into contact. However, there is the plus side. There's the performances of Ruan Nerkeer, the man who played with precision and intellect throughout. Proof once again that Rashi has discovered an absolute baller of a lock to add depth to his squad, whilst Oxnard and Che put in an incredible 65 minutes in the suffocating heat. It was an evening that could have and might have turned out quite differently had Manny Le Bok not fluffed a kick in the 77th minute to win the match. And it says everything that, about the Springboks, that a kick he'd nailed 99 times out of 100 went wide, and with it, the hope of a nation. So all to play for still next week in Mbombela. In terms of player rating, I'm going to go to Ultimate Rugby this time to just give you a sense of what their player rating were. Let's start with the losing team, the Springboks. For Apalele Fassi, they gave 7.7 out of 10 points. He scored the first try and he was solid under the high ball. His left boot gave the Springboks another kicking option, but one or two contestable kicks of him were too far, and he made the most meters in the game, namely 98 meters. At number 14, Kurt Lee-Arensley, they gave him 6 points out of 10. He made a few wrong calls on defense. He was yellow carded in the 17th minute for the shoulder against the head tackle that cost the Springboks. Jesse Creel, they gave 6 points out of 10. He had a good short line to score the second try in the game, but he got caught out a few times on the outside. Lucanio Am, they've given 7 out of 10 points. He and Kiel got caught a few times on defence. Were with Argentina playing out of the back and on attack, he made a team break, one off late, and he beat one defender. Makazole Mpimpi, they gave 7 points out of 10. The veteran winger was caught out a few times on defence. He missed a simple chip kick in the 60th minute, and he returned kicks with some strong carries. Andre Pollard was given a score out of 8 out of 10. It was a good flat pass to Fassi for his first try, and good distance on his touch kicks and 100% off the tee. Kobus Reinig. They gave 8 points out of 10. One or two wrong decisions on attacks. Scored a third try from the quick tap. Great clearance kick in his 47th minute when South Africa was under huge pressure and he made 51 passes. I personally felt that he made a few of his kicks were unnecessary, especially one that he senselessly kicked the ball away over his head. Jasper Wiese, they gave a score out of 7 out of 10. He won an important line-out for the Springboks just before halftime. He was one of the strongest runners in the Springbok pack, and he made 10 tackles. Ben Jason Dixon, they gave 7 out of 10 points. Great support plan attack, brought the physicality for the 50 minutes he played, and he threw two great offloads. Marco van Staden, they gave 7 out of 10. A try-saving tackle from van Staden in the 7th minute. He was subbed off in the 50th minute, but had a very busy game. Ruan Norkia, unfortunately, the score is not there, but I think he did very well. I would have given him a 9 out of 10 score. He had good takes on the receiving kickoffs. He had a big work rate from the lock, and he made 7 tackles and won 1 turnover. Salman Murat, they scored 8 out of 10. A few big tackles in the first half from the South African captain that kept him in the game, and some strong carries of the scrum off, and he can be proud of his 15 minutes. However, personally, I still think we need to see more of Salman Murat. He's got such potential from junior days, and although Ultimate Rugby scored him 8 out of 10, I still thought he disappeared a bit at times in the match. Thomas de Toer, they gave 7 out of 10 points. He was solid at scrum time and some great support play and attack. Malcolm Marks, 8 out of 10. Accurate throwing in the lineouts in the main and a few good carries that helped the Springboks to get momentum. And then for me, one of the best Springbok players in the pack, Oxnard-Chair, 8 out of 10. He ran great lines off number 9. He played for 64th minute. He won a number of penalties in the scrums and he beat 4 defenders. That is Ultimate Rugby's rating of the Springboks players. Unfortunately for the Argentinian team, the Ultimate Rugby website only gave them the scores with no narrative, so I'm just going to go through those quickly. In the front row, Thomas Gallo, they gave 6 points out of 10. Number 2, the captain Julian Montoya, 7 out of 10. Number 3, the big prop Joel Sclavi, who scored a try from a lineout, 7 out of 10. The two locks, Franco Molina, 6 out of 10. Pedro Rebulu, 7 out of 10. And then as far as loose forwards concerned, who I think played very well together, Pablo Montera, 7 out of 10. Marcos Kremer, 7 out of 10. He was sub later in the game when he was injured. And Iceman Jacquin Ovidio, 8 out of 10. If one looks at the back line, the standout player there is Thomas Albornoz. They gave him 9 out of 10. If Gonzalez, better know the scrum half, 7 out of 10. When you look at the two centers, Santi Corbares, 8 out of 10. Lucia Sinti, also 8 out of 10. The wings, Matteo Carrera, 7 out of 10. And Batista Delgai, also 7 out of 10. And in back line, June Cruz Malia, 7 out of 10. It's pity they didn't provide a narrative, but overall the scores for the Argentinian players, I think, accurately reflected their passion and their effort, especially the back three and the back line. And I also agree that Thomas Albornoz were their best player on the field, and it clearly also comes out of the rating.